in the suffering that your Son so patiently endured for us. Lord, fill us with an ever greater appreciation for the sacrifice you made for us. All the worship and praise that we can give cannot thank you enough for what you have done for us. Accept our praise today, increase our faith and love for you. Hear us for Jesus' sake. Amen.
Service this morning, and we begin our worship in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, imploring him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord. Almighty God, our Maker and Redeemer, we poor sinners confess unto thee that we are by nature sinful and unclean, and that we have sinned against thee by thought, word, and deed. Therefore we flee for refuge to thine infinite mercy, seeking and imploring thy grace for the sake of our Lord Jesus Christ. O most merciful God, who has given thine only begotten Son to die for us, have mercy upon us, and for his sake grant us remission of all our sins. And by thy Holy Spirit, increase in us to knowledge of thee and of thy will, and true obedience to thy word, to the end that by thy grace we may come to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, has had mercy upon us and has given his only Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. To them that believe on his name, he gives power to become the sons of God and has promised them his Holy Spirit. He that believes and is baptized shall be saved. Grant this, Lord, unto us all. The Lord be with you. O Lord, mercifully hear our prayer, and stretch forth the right hand of thy majesty to defend us from them that rise up against us. Through Jesus Christ, thy Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with thee in the Holy Ghost, one God, now and forever. Our scripture reading, the first one is from the book of Psalms 85, verses 8 to 13. Ties in well with what we were speaking of in Bible class this morning, as we indeed confess that we will hear the word of the Lord, because it is in the word of our Lord that we find our strength, our confidence, and our hope. I will hear what the Lord will speak, for he will speak peace to his people and to his saints. But let them not turn back to folly. Surely his salvation is near to those who fear him, that glory may dwell in our land. Mercy and truth have met together. Righteousness and peace have kissed. Truth shall spring out of the earth, and righteousness shall look down from heaven. Yes, the Lord will give what is good, and our land will yield its increase. Righteousness will go before him, and shall make his footsteps our pathway. Alleluia, alleluia. The word of the Lord is proven. He is a shield to all who trust in him. Alleluia. Reading for this morning is found in the second chapter of John, reading verses 13 to 22.
words Jesus gives us, indeed, his instruction as to what his house is to be for us and to us, and how we are to conduct ourselves within it. Now the Passover of the Jews was at hand, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. And he found in the temple those who sold oxen and sheep and doves, and the money changers doing business. When he had made a whip of cords, he drove them all out of the temple with the sheep and the oxen, and poured out the changers' money and overturned the tables. And he said to those who sold doves, "Take these things away. Do not make my Father's house a house of merchandise." Then his disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house has eaten me up." So the Jews answered and said to him, "What sign do you show to us since you do these things?" Jesus answered and said to them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." Then the Jews said, "It has taken 46 years to build this temple, and you will raise it up in 3 days?" But he was speaking of the temple of his body. Therefore, when he had risen from the dead, his disciples remembered he had said this to them, and they believed the scripture and the word which Jesus had said. Here ends the reading. And we confess our Christian faith in the words of the Apostolic Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Thank you. grace unto you in peace to God our Father, and to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. God's word for our meditation this morning is recorded in Paul's first letter to the Corinthians in the first chapter, verses 22 to 25. For the Jews require a sign, and the Greeks seek after wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified. Unto the Jews a stumbling block, and unto the Greeks foolishness. But unto them which are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God, and the wisdom of God. Because the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. These are the words. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Word made flesh, and therefore the wisdom of God unto salvation, dear fellow redeemed. To a great extent today, people are interested more in entertainment and being entertained than anything else. And with television that presents news and other programming in short snippets, attention spans have decreased so that for many it is difficult to sit for an hour, for a focused hour, and to listen, particularly if there is nothing that will stimulate the visions or the visual emotion. Now there is something to be said for what we did before the service when we had a Bible class. There's something to be said for interactive study of Scripture, as we do in Bible class and Sunday school. Yes, we can learn through visuals, but we learn also through asking questions, through interactive discussion in Bible study. And indeed, we may occasionally introduce visual aids even into the worship service. However, we want to encourage appreciation of quiet, focused sitting at the foot of the cross as Mary sat at the feet of Jesus to hear him speak the word. There is something to be said for a focused time to read the scripture and apply it. And only when we sit and listen attentively can we appreciate what the verse preceding our text says. For after that, in the wisdom of God, the world by wisdom did not know God. It pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believed. Now the foolishness of preaching, as Paul uses it here, is not the act of preaching, but the content of the preaching. In contrast to the wisdom of men, which rejects the way of salvation, the wisdom of men which finds God in self, the wisdom of man which finds in himself how he would live to satisfy his own agenda. It is through the wisdom of the gospel, the wisdom of God, that God accomplishes his will for mankind. And what is his will? That people hear the word, hear the gospel, that they believe it, and indeed come to salvation. You see, the wisdom of men cannot ever lift us up to communion or fellowship with God. The wisdom of men, and we're certainly seeing that today, and it's not only today, but it's been since sin. The wisdom of man cannot bring peace to the heart, and it will never bring peace or comfort in the hour of death. It took the gospel, God's wisdom. This claim, which we make on the basis of Scripture, however, intensifies the impression in the minds of those who do not believe
that the gospel is foolishness. But our God was not dissuaded by what man thinks. And frankly, neither should we be. God did not accommodate himself to satisfy the world's wisdom. He went counter to it. That in turn shows a mistake that we make and that churches make today. If we try to make Christ, if we try to make God's word, if we try to make the gospel palatable to our age, or try to accommodate the gospel to the wisdom of this world in order to make it reasonable to men. The gospel is not an argument. The gospel is not a piece of reasoning gauged to convince men. It is an announcement of facts, such as we have before us today when we say we preach Christ crucified. The church is commissioned to preach the gospel, Christ crucified. But you see, this is a stumbling block to most people. Paul said, "For the Jews require a sign, and the Greeks seek after wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified, unto the Jews a stumbling block, and unto the Greeks foolishness." There is a natural resistance to the word of God. That's why Luther declared, and we confess in the third article of the Creed, "I believe that I cannot by my own reason or strength believe in Jesus Christ my Lord or come to him, but the Holy Ghost has called me by the gospel." The natural mind is an enmity with God, dead in trespasses and sins. As we spoke in Bible class, Adam and Eve hid when they sinned. They didn't go out looking for God. And neither does man today. The Spirit of God himself comes to us through the gospel, creates the desire to hear, as well as the faith to believe. Yes, the Holy Ghost has called me by the gospel. Faith itself is a gift from God. But there are those who say that faith is not sufficient. They'll believe the word if the truth can be verified by some other means. This is what they say, but this is not what they mean. The Jews demanded signs to demonstrate that Jesus was the Messiah. But you don't have to read very far into the Gospels to find out that Jesus had left them with many signs already. He healed the sick. He gave sight to the blind. He fed the poor. He raised the dead. He had given them already all kinds of signs in the course of his ministry. But it was almost like a little child will say, "Just one more. Give me just one more sign." And so they're asking for one more sign till the day they die. The fact is, they didn't want to receive him as the Messiah, as the anointed Christ, as that one who came to bring forgiveness and eternal life. They did not want the signs of grace and mercy. They didn't accept those which he had already shown. They wanted some spectacular sign, something really that caught their attention from heaven. Do you remember Herod? He was anxious to see Jesus because he wanted to see some miracle done by him. But Jesus, in fact, said, and we heard here a sign, he would destroy this temple in 3 days, I will raise it up again. And another time Jesus said, "There will be no sign given to this generation but the sign of Jonah." And what is that? the resurrection from the dead. Now, the same demand for signs is evident today in the charismatic movement with its emphasis on signs. The touchstone of truth for them is not the simple proclamation of the Word of God, the simple proclamation of the gospel. They need the signs, speaking in tongues, laying on of hands to heal the sick, and such things as that. At the same time, the church growth movement feels a need to enhance the Word through gimmicks, as though the Word itself is not sufficient. Today, the church that carries out the commission that the Lord has given it to preach the gospel to every creature is not as popular as a church that does what incite a man are big things. You see, what are some of the big things? Well, let's get out and let's protest war. Let's get out and agitate either for or against immigration. Things of that nature. That's really what makes a church a living church. It shows that it is alive. For the Jews and for such as demand signs beyond the word itself, the preaching of the gospel, the quiet sitting and listening as you are doing right at this moment, is foolishness. It's a stumbling block. And then there are the Greeks, or the Gentiles. Paul mentioned them. They wanted a religion that challenged their intelligence. They were into philosophy, into the love of wisdom, the love of the wisdom of men, into speculation that would titillate the mind. They were forever looking for the truth. But for them, the truth is as far as the east is from the west. They never find it. They have the mindset of Pilate. What is truth? The message of an itinerant preacher who claimed to be the Son of God, and in fact who declared that it showed that he was God, was foolishness to them. And it's that attitude that reflects itself today as a response to a simple confession of faith. You mean, you really believe that? What are you doing to show that you are a Christian, that your church is alive? The wisdom of God, or the wisdom of the Greeks, has begotten evolution. The wisdom of men has begotten speculative education. Education without absolutes, which we're not supposed to talk about, because there's nothing that's absolute in this world, they say. I'm so pleased, I thank God, that you people are now, with by the grace of God, going to have a Christian day school where you can give your children a chance to know the truth without the foolishness of the world. Yes. The wisdom of men begets those things, but will not speak about the absolutes of God's word, the absolute of sin and its consequence, and the absoluteness of God's love for you and for the sinner and what he has done to make you his own. In spite of all this, the Lord preserves his gospel. Just think about that. There's no attack upon anything more since again the fall than the gospel. And it still is here. They can't get rid of it. It sounds forth in the midst of a wayward generation in which we live. And to those who are saved, the Savior and his cross is the wisdom unto salvation. Paul wrote, but unto them which are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God, because the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. Sinners who believe the word and promise of God look differently at the gospel. We don't look at it differently because we're different people. We look at it differently because as we read it, it has demonstrated its power and its wisdom in our heart. We lost and condemned creatures have a peace and a quietness of heart. Something that science seekers and philosophers of the world cannot ever find. They are pursuing it like chasing the end of the rainbow. You have. And this again gets us back to Bible class. Our confidence of salvation is not based on our feeling. Our confidence of salvation is based upon the sound, absolute, infallible word of God. Your sins are forgiven you, whether you feel it or not. We are not saved by feeling. We're saved through faith. And faith is established on the soundness of God's word. As the Spirit of God has miraculously overcome our heart and converted us, we've been led to see and appreciate this wisdom and power of God. And so, God's word is not foolishness, nor is it weak, though the world looks at it that way. But for sake of the argument, the manner in which the apostle addressed it is interesting. Basically, you think God's word and God's plan of salvation is foolishness? It's crazy? Well, let me tell you something. It's still wiser than your wisdom. Wiser than all the accumulated wisdom of men. How they fight against it, how they deny it. But what is the proof? Both in fact as well as in experience. It's this. Christ rose from the dead. Wouldn't have happened unless he was crucified. And therefore we preach Christ crucified, that we might understand and appreciate the resurrection. And what does the resurrection say to you? It says, through Christ, because I live, you shall live. I am the resurrection and life. He that believes in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Foolishness to the world, but it is to you the peace of God which passes all understanding and is recorded by none less than God himself. So let the world pursue a nebulous peace. Oh yes, witness to it, but don't be turned away. Don't be cowed by their accusations. They're looking for a champion that's going to provide for them what they want, behind whom they can rally. Christ is our champion. Christ has accomplished everything and more than we could ever have thought or desired. It's written in the word. Paul said, therefore, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also for the Greek. For in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith. Now again, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. You can look it up.
It's been there since God gave his word. And so, we make no apology, and we feel no need in our day to update the message. We preach Christ crucified, the love of God unto salvation. Amen. And may this peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your heart and mind in Christ Jesus unto life everlasting. Amen.
Peace.
O Almighty God, Heavenly Father, we thank you that you have given us a high priest, Jesus Christ, who knows our infirmities since he bore them, who understands our trials and troubles since he endured them. All praise to you for the love you have shown us in your Son. O Lamb of God, you were slain as a sacrifice for the sins of the world and have become the author of our salvation and for all who trust in you. Give us such faith and trust that we listen to your voice, may find the true joy of conforming our wills to your holy will. We find ourselves in temptations, deliver us by your power and save us from all evil. Help us to wrestle daily against the powers of darkness which are present in every circumstance of life. Overthrow Satan, our evil foe, in every assault on our souls. Make us strong in you, and by your example, show us the victorious power of your word. Let your blessing rest upon our homes, O Lord. Give all parents wisdom and grace to be true followers of him who is the light of the world, so that by their manner of living they may be worthy examples for their children. Dear Lord, bless our country and those in every office and calling, that they may lead our nation in a way that is pleasing to you. For those among us who are afflicted with suffering and pain, grant that they may see your gentle hand of guiding love in whatever ails them. For those who sorrow, give the comfort of your promises. For those in need, show yourself the source of all good. If any are dying, give them the confidence that through this, though this earthly body is destroyed, we already have a new and glorious life in Christ and the promise of glorious resurrection when he comes again. Help us always to accept the wisdom of the gospel in faith by the power of the Spirit. Now, dear Father, give your angels charge over all your people to minister to their salvation, to bring them safely through this world to the eternal kingdom which you have prepared for those who place their trust alone in your Savior. In his name we pray and also say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.